Good morning, members. It's the appointed time and we have a quorum. We will discuss four papers today. Before the meeting, the government submitted paper ECI 2018-19, number 3, for members' reference. And the paper sets out the changes in directorate establishment approved since 2002 and the impacts of the changes involved in the 6 discussion items in the directorate establishment. I remind members that if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interests for the items to be discussed today, please disclose the nature of such interest before you speak, per Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure. I'd like to call members' attention to the voting arrangements in case of direct pecuniary interests under Rule 84. Item number 1. Propose making permanent of one supernumerary post of Deputy Principal Government Counsel, DL2, in the Legal Policy Division of the Department of Justice with immediate effect upon approval by the Finance Committee to undertake essential duties in respect of constitutional and electoral matters. The subcommittee discussed the item on the 4th of June, so I won't introduce the government officials again. Two members are waiting to speak. They are not present. Does any other member wish to raise questions? Mr. Wu Chi-wai, first round. Thank you, Chairman. When the issue was discussed at the panel, there was a lot of discussion. This is the post responsible for constitutional development and elections. I'd like to know where the focus of work would be. When carrying out duties on constitutional development and elections, I'd like to know what kind of advice would be given by the Deputy Principal Government Counsel in case of disqualifications. I'd like to know about the duties of the Government Counsel in constitutional development and elections. Can you elaborate on that? Mr. Wong, thank you very much. At the establishment subcommittee at panel meetings, this issue has been discussed, and this post would take care of constitutional development and elections. And in terms of constitutional development, we mentioned enhancing our existing electoral system, and if constitutional reform is to be restarted, this unit will provide legal advice to the government. And for an election from voter registration to election day, if legal advice is needed, it will be provided by this unit. Legal advice would be tendered to any government departments involved, and such advice must be neutral and non-political. In the last meeting, Mr. Gary Fan asked whether the advice could be disclosed. The answer is no, because the legal advice is protected by legal professional privilege. And this ensures that the government departments can obtain legal advice in confidence. and the relevant government departments would make their decisions. The ultimate decisions might face legal challenges, and there might be litigations. Therefore, the legal advice given must be accurate, professional, and sound. Chairman, this is where the problem lies. When we deal with electoral legislation, we are talking about the application of political rights. In the recent incidents of disqualification, we asked the government about their justifications when they disqualify the candidates. We did not know how they arrived at the decisions of disqualification. The DOJ plays a very important role in the disqualifications. So if we are not able to debate the legal advice obtained by the government, the public would have doubts about the impartiality of the elections. If you only rely on the legal professional privilege system, would that be sufficient? Mr. Wang? It is about the necessity of the legal advice, but not the actual content. This is not just about the registration and electoral office. The returning officer would make decisions according to their statutory powers. If you label it as disqualifications, it might not be appropriate. We are talking about the effectiveness of nominations, and despite the final decision of the returning officer, the nomination might be challenged. And this doesn't just apply to ineffective nominations, even effective ones can be challenged. So at the end of the day, we must have faith in the system, and we must ensure access to justice, and if any candidates or voters have opposing views, there would be a channel available to voice their objections. And the returning officers must obtain accurate legal advice so that in case of litigations, the returning officers can back their decisions. Dr. Fernando Cheng, second round. Thank you. The post is a Deputy Principal Government Counsel, who would be responsible for constitutional development and elections, and he would provide legal advice to the returning officers. Of course, this is a pivotal role. We have seen many elections since the handover. As one of the candidates, I never saw any returning officer vetoing the or any candidates from running in an election, and this only happened recently. the work of the returning officer went from procedural or administrative to a political and legal level when they disqualified candidates. This is certainly something new. So I have a question for the DOJ. Can you tell us the reason for such change? I realize that when you tender legal advice to the returning officer, you would only consider legal perspectives, and you would only consider from a technical perspective whether a candidate is eligible. The role and practice of the returning officer has changed. Does it have anything to do with the change of the DOJ? Thank you very much. Of course, any issue that is debated at LegCo would be important. This post and his team are responsible for providing legal advice on constitutional development and elections. And we realize that members have raised questions on the legitimacy of the candidates for a candidate, whether or not his or her candidacy is deemed valid or not. Very often, the candidate, other candidates, or voters in that particular constituency might find the ultimate decisions made political, but the process is actually the same for a government unit seeking legal advice. If they feel that legal advice is needed, government counsel would offer the advice based on the relevant legal principles. And this is completely in line with their duty as legal advice providers. I was asking about the change. Does it stem from this post? Mr. Felix Chong, first round. Thank you. We do not have elections every single year, though we have the district council election next year and the legislative election 2 years later. Since we do not always have elections, can't the work of this post be taken up by other divisions, or even can you brief out the cases to private counsel?
副部长.
So what will this council be responsible for with the creation of this post? Mr. Wong, thank you, Mr. Chong, for your question. We have to emphasize that whether it is a election year or re-election, this is actually recurrent, and then we are talking about a huge amount of work. In the panel meeting on Monday afternoon, we did provide some figures. Mr. Chong asked whether there is a need for the creation of a new post. Perhaps I could defer to Mr. Mui to answer your question. Thank you. Madam Chair, thank you, Mr. Zhong. Let me try to explain briefly what this post will be responsible for in terms of election work. As Mr. Zhong pointed out, there would be registration issues, and during election years, there would be work that involves pre-election preparation and post-election work. For registration, it occurs every year, and I think members will know that for registration of voters, we will need to see whether they're eligible, and when the registration and electoral office receives information, then they would consider it based on the legal factors, and they would also need to seek legal advice from this division. Oh, this is recurrent work, and we are talking about a large amount of work just solely in registration. Then there would also be procedures for post-election litigation, and when there is a case, then this division would also need to provide support. This is only an example. Mr. Chong asked whether we could contract out these services. I don't think it can really be done, because this is recurrent, and if we subcontract the services, then it would create problems in operations, and we need to ensure that the quality of this work. So our consideration is based on the factors I have just mentioned, and so it is not quite suitable for contracting out. We also need a professional team, and therefore we believe that we need the creation of a permanent post. Oh, so Mr. Moy gave the example on voters registration, that you might need to seek legal advice. But actually, voters registration is a very simple process. The CMAB can actually deal with these basic issues. Would there be so much legal advice needed by the DPGC? Mr. Wong. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chung, for your question. Mr. Mui can supplement details later on. I believe that voters' registration procedures are relatively simple, but there may be some cases that need legal advice, which may be infrequent issues. For example, issues with address. Voters may have more than one address, or they may not be living permanently at that address. And those voters may not have lived in Hong Kong consecutively for 7 years, and so we will need to consider whether they are eligible to become a voter. If I could refer you to paragraph 13 of the paper, you would see the issues needed to be dealt with. I'm not sure if Mr. Mui has any additional information. Mr. Mui, thank you, Madam Chair. In paragraph 13, we have explained voter registration work, there might be a litigation. Created, and therefore there would need to be certain legal procedures. The lawyers from the division would need to attend the hearing to provide support and information to the court. Of course, not every case is like that. And not all the cases would be brought up to the DPGC to be handled by him personally. And there are two other government councils are responsible for the work, and the DPGC would be there supervising to ensure that there would be consistency in the work. Mr. Martin Liu, first round. Thank you, Madam Chair. I think this item has been discussed and at the AJLSP before, but then at that time there was a lot of filibustering and the item was not brought up for discussion to the ESC and FC. And it has been delayed till today, and so this post has been taken out for 1 year, and even the personal assistant post has already been taken out. And during this time, there have been many by-elections, including the Central and Western District in 2017, and then in the March 2017 elections, and actually the EDC this year. And so this division needs to support all these elections, and you can see that the work has increased continuously, whether it be providing legal advice to the legal division or in providing legal advice on voters registration. You also have to act as returning officers to provide legal advice on site and to help with polling. So they do have huge pressure on manpower, and that also involves their daily operational work. And in the upcoming years, there are going to be few major elections, and so you can see that there's only going to be an increase in election work. Therefore, there is a need to create a new post. The opposing party keeps on trying to deter this from happening. We have to ensure that there is enough manpower to provide legal advice, to support and to lead the division at the CPD. At the same time, this person needs to handle controversial legal issues. So I don't think you should say that there is any political issues linked to it. Some people say that there is also elections also linked to the government, but I think that this is ridiculous. We are faced with many different elections, and the DOJ needs to provide a strong legal basis to ensure that the government will be able to make decisions based on the rule of law. The DOJ also has the responsibility to provide legal support and to handle sensitive legal issues that are on the rise. And on staff who are has the expertise in human rights and in basic law, then we also need to ensure that there will be enough legal support for that. I don't need any response from the administration. Thank you. Third round, Mr. Chen Chi-chun. Well, I think that Mr. Liao should provide us with his speech, because that would really help us to vote for this item. We have discussed this for quite some time. If you think that what Mr. Martin Liao has said and what is raised in paragraph 13, you would see that we're not only talking about the creation of a new post, we're actually looking at problems with inadequate manpower. Mr. Wong said he has provided many numbers, but I have read this paragraph in detail. And the largest number I see here is that prior to the DC in November 2015, there was a record high of over 1,500 cases of claims and objections arising from voter registration and entitlement, and the council of the entire CDNU had to attend court hearings for two consecutive weeks. Well, I'm not sure whether this is a special case. You have that you're talking about 1,500 cases. So no matter how many people you recruit, you would still not be able to handle so many cases. I don't see other figures in paragraph 13. I only see that there are six election petitions, and then three respective returning officers and the Secretary of Justice were named as respondents. Can you give us a number on how many hours were used in this work? And I'm also concerned with experts outside of the division. So the Solicitor General said that this is a specific kind of legal advice. But I would have thought that a counsel in the LPD would be most familiar with the election issues in Hong Kong. I don't think any private lawyers would have the same knowledge. So I really cannot understand what kind of difficulties you are facing, and when you need to, or whether, or when you need to contract out the services. Well, here in paragraph 13, you said that there are 1,500 cases of claims and objections. So would you need to hire part-timers to help you out? I really don't quite understand. Mr. Wong. Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Mr. Chen, for your question. We deferred you to paragraph 13 to address the problem raised by Mr. Chong. We're talking about a large amount of work here, and Mr. Mui can tell you how to quantify the work here. But targeting Mr. Chen's question, perhaps I could give you a bit more background information to enhance your understanding.
First of all, as for the need to brief out cases, I hope that the DOJ would be equipped with all the legal expertise and knowledge to deal with all the cases. But for election-related cases, very often they involve specific areas of legal knowledge that would call for the need for relevant experts and academics. And this is not very common, but it does happen. That's why the number of cases was not very high. As for briefing out cases, apart from the factors cited by Mr. Mui, for example, quality control, briefing out might not be the best practice, because some issues might involve more universal issues, and these issues must be dealt with as soon as possible, or else that would lead to inconsistent legal advice offered by different parties, and sometimes they might conflict with each other, which can lead to further legal challenges. As for manpower deployment, and due to election cycles or voter registration suggested in paragraph 13, if there are legal challenges, there are time limits for court appearances. That's why we have two permanent government counsel, and if necessary, we would deploy staff from other units of the DOJ. And this is a move to save manpower resources, and we hope to maximize the use of our talents. However, different units would need to be supervised by respective heads, and this is exactly the post of DPGC for this item. For the number of cases mentioned in paragraph 13, prior to the district council election in November 2015, there was a number of cases, and we wanted to use this as an example for the election-related legal issues dealt with by supernumerary staff. It was an example, and I do not quite understand Mr. Ray Chan's request for more numbers. Please wait for your next round. Mr. Uchiwai, second round. And this post would take care of election matters, and paragraph 13 mentioned legal challenges due to voter registration, and we also dealing with the legitimacy of the candidates, and the post also needs to deal with legal issues from constitutional development, including universal suffrage. Of course, we hope that constitutional reform can be restarted, but we do not see how the government has any plans to restart the reform in the coming future. And we do not see when constitutional reform would be restarted. And with voter registration, we saw a number of cases, but we should not allow these to happen every single time, because you should have learned your lesson. You should have refined the voter registration system. I do not believe that voter registration would become a recurrent problem. Even if you have issues, there shouldn't be too many of them. Or else the REO would face fundamental issues. And since constitutional reform is not likely to be restarted anytime soon. There isn't enough justification to make this post permanent. So given the circumstances, why do you think this permanent post is necessary? Mr. Wong. Thank you very much for the question. In terms of constitutional affairs, the work is taken up by this unit, and paragraphs 16 to 19 explain the work in detail. As for when constitutional reform would be restarted, that would be the work of the Bureau. But the work would be taken up by this unit of the DOJ. The previous constitutional reform package was vetoed by LegCo, and election-related work had occupied most of their time. That's why we find it justified to make this post regular or permanent. Because we saw that we need enough staff to deal with election affairs. As for VR, it is useful to accumulate experience, but we are looking at isolated cases, and for each case, we must make decisions based on the circumstances. If there are legal challenges, a judiciary officer or magistrate would be required, so support is needed. Last time, Ms. Oden Chow asked about this as well. He asked whether the structure or establishment can be streamlined. If there are any amendments to the legislation, the workload of this unit would become heavier, because if there are any changes, the unit still has to provide legal support. Dr. Fernando Chang, fourth round. Third round, rather. I asked about the disqualification of candidates. We only started to see that in the 2016 legislative election and subsequent by-elections. So I asked whether these had to do with the existence of this post. We asked whether the legal advice given might be biased, and Mr. Wong said the legal advice must be able to withstand legal challenges. So for the legal advice tendered to the returning officer or for decisions to disqualify certain candidates, the specific individuals can launch an election petition or file a judicial review to the court. But there is a price to be paid in these challenges. They involve substantial sums of money, and legal aid is not guaranteed. the government has almost boundless powers and money. When you make decisions or provide legal advice on the legitimacy of candidates, shouldn't you consider the element of fairness? And Mr. Wong said we can take the matters to the court if we are not satisfied. The government has vast resources. This is not something this is not the right attitude to embrace. Thank you very much for the question. As a professional legal advice provider, we would not invite people to challenge our legal advice, but rather, since there is a possibility of legal challenges, we must ensure that our legal advice is accurate. Mr. Gary Fan, second round. Thank you. Mr. Wong and the other members of the ESC asked for further figures in order to justify making this DPGC post permanent. And paragraph 13 of the paper provided some figures. It mentioned the 2015 District Council election, the 2016 legislative election, the review of the qualification of LegCo members and the by-election in October for the Central and Western District, Eastern District, and so on. Mr. Wong said there is an urgency to the post. But there are certain issues not mentioned in the paper, and there were questions asked by members which have not been answered. Some have to do with the public's right to know and the legislature's right to know. And Mr. Wong talked about legal professional privilege. We asked about the judicial review of six LegCo members in September 2016 and the resources required, and these would affect whether we support the creation of this post. And the government told the ESC at the time that the relevant litigations were underway. As for the eventual manpower and fees required, it would depend on the developments of the case.
I understand that for the disqualified members, then some are still under legal procedures because some are still appealing. I want to ask if you can provide this information to us now to see whether you have more information compared to 12 months ago on the appeal cases to the CDNEU on the increase of resources used for these cases, because these numbers would help us to determine whether there is a need to create a post of DPGC. Mr. Wong.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Mr. Fan, for your question. Actually,
I need to express that we cannot see this creation of post as a new post, because this is actually an extension of a current post, because this post has actually existed for quite some time, and based on past experiences, we see that the responsible staff has already used time working on these issues. On the six cases of disqualified members, we did not separate them into individual cases. Let me ask if Mr. Mui can give you some other figures. Mr. Mui. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Mr. Fan, for your question. I can try give you some numbers on legal advice sought in the past few years for reference. There is a need for this post, because when we started creating this post in April 2012, this division provided 726 advice and 600 cases in 2013 and about 700 cases in 2014. So 2013, 2014 were non-election years, but then the numbers increased in 2015 up to 1,007 cases, because there were district council elections, and then in 2016 1,232 cases, because it was an election year for LegCo. Last year was not an election year, but then this division also provided 572 pieces of legal advice. I hope that this can be used as a reference for members' consideration to allow us to create this permanent post. Thank you. Dr. K.K. Kwok, first round. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, in the past, we really believe and recognize the work of DOJ. But ever since the last government and transitioned to the new government, we see that a lot, many legal advice has been working to the benefit of the government to help make unfair decisions. For example, on qualifications of LegCo members, in March this year, a candidate was disqualified based on immature views, and altogether six candidates would go for JR as they would be disqualified. So this has become a political problem. We cannot be complacent and allow this division to become a warrior for the administration. So you're using the court and prosecution as tools. We can't tell people that this is a fair election. Candidates can just be disqualified based on uncertain factors. Well, we have signed the United Nations agreement, but you know, I feel very embarrassed. What are you doing here? You're now trying to interpret the basic law and to try to disqualify a large number of candidates in Hong Kong. You have the gall to actually come out and say that you are doing something in the interest of Hong Kong. Many more candidates would be disqualified based on your so-called legal advice. Do you really want to hire more people to help you work on this political work, Mr. Wong? Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Dr. Kwok, for your concern. In response to your question, I must point out that Dr. Kwok used sort of like a a beater or a hired rogue to work for you, but so this is not a hatchet man, as Dr. Kwok said. For example, on whether the election is fair, we want to ensure that people are safeguarded. So so candidates might be challenged based on legal basis, and therefore you might ultimately need to go for litigation. As the saying goes, you might be able to please one side but not the other. And so it can always be challenged by the person who is not satisfied. So this is what happens. And it is the same for elections. Therefore, DOJ must provide legal advice without political considerations, and therefore we need the creation of this post to provide non-biased legal advice. First round, Mr. James Toh. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, I'm a lawyer, although I don't practice quite often nowadays. Why, I hope you don't worry too much about the so-called hatchet man issue. Well, if you want to disqualify a candidate, then yes, you can consider it to try to see how you can DQ someone from that point. If you believe that the DQ is wrong, then you know you are just an employee. You just think of something. If you really can't find any excuses, then you should say so. If you can, then of course you would give it a try. So do you really call this a hatchet man? Well, some people may really enjoy this role. They like to disqualify people, but some people may be more neutral, and they try to come up with reasons for disqualification. But I don't think you need to mind too much what other people think of you. Even if you are trying to defend a murderer, the plaintiff might still think that this is a hatchet man only. But if you lie too much, then maybe people will not believe you. But you know, as we're talking about a profession, it happens all the time. Well, let me go back to the paper. I see in paragraph 16 and 17 that those two paragraphs are quite interesting. It talks about universal suffrage, and there's a lot of work to be done for universal suffrage. In paragraph 16, you said that the ultimate aim is to go for universal suffrage, and there would be a lot of work. Well, if universal suffrage is a go-ahead, of course, this is something I want as the Democratic Party. But realistically, you're only working in research, and you are also working as a hatchet man. But some people may really hate universal suffrage. I met with someone yesterday who really hates this idea. The administration is trying to wait for a perfect timing to implement this, but I'm not sure whether you are working in this already. So are you just trying to tell us vaguely that you are working towards this goal? Or, as you said, there's already someone working in this post. You just want to try to make this supernumerary post become permanent, and you're looking forward to more work in the future. Well, if that is if that is the way forward, then of course it would be good news for us, Mr. Wong. Paragraphs 16 to 19 are put in the paper not because we're trying to make a selling point. We are just trying to change a supernumerary post into a permanent post. And other members have already understood that we are looking into constitutional development and also on registration. In paragraph 16, it is already mentioned that even when we started this work in 2012, there were two main goals, and in future, when it becomes a permanent post, this division will still be responsible for the same work. But experience shows that electoral affairs have already taken up most of the time of the division. Therefore, we have very good reason to request a creation of this permanent post. And this would help with our constitutional reform. Second round, Mr. Aonokin. Thank you, Madam Chair. I remember that Mr. Wong told us something quite interesting a couple of days ago, that decisions would be based on the needs, and then the division will decide based on the law to make the decisions. Do you really know what you're talking about? Many members are talking about political decisions. You just choose to interpret the law the way you want. So we have the the electoral affairs mission. We also have different ordinances that you choose to work towards your benefit. So that is why you say you have the power. But even if that's the case, why would there be so many members saying that there is this so-called hatchet man role? But I do not want to go into more details here.
2016年,
if you think back to 2016, when LegCo members were disqualified, the then Secretary of Justice, Mr. Rimsky-Yun, said openly that local courts can deal with such controversies. But at the end, we saw interpretation of the basic law by the MPC, SC, ahead of the judgment of the court, and it was a slap on the SJ's face. I asked whether the senior assistant counsel did made any decisions, and would the interpretation of the law by the MPCSC breach Basic Law Article 158? So what was your thought process at the time? Did you follow the DOJ or the MPCSC? Thank you very much. If the returning officer exercises their statutory powers, I don't see why that is a problem. I'm talking about two sets of law. Ms. Ao asked this question on Monday afternoon, and I gave a clear answer. Does the returning officer have a choice to make? And this is something that must be resolved through our outstanding litigation. I can confirm that there are some legal requirements on how the returning officer obtains legal advice, since the issue must be resolved through litigation. I cannot discuss it in depth. As for the interpretation of the law by the NPCSC, it does not belong to Article 150. It should be Article 158. This has to do with BL 104 on the oath of the taking of oath. And for Article 158, when we look at the judgment by Mr. Ao and the judgment of the Court of Appeal and the Court of Final Appeal, it was a right of the NPC. I do not want Mr. Wong to comment on the case itself. My question was whether Mr. Rimsky-Yun's or Mr. Rimsky-Yun's decision or the MPCSC decision, which one would be overriding? Your time is up, Mr. Ao. Please wait for your next round. Dr. K. Kwok, second round. Chairman. I think what affects the morale of the DOJ most is that the DOJ is carrying out political censorship. It is made a political apparatus. And I think any counsel with any conscience would find this shameful. I agree with Mr. Wong that you cannot satisfy everyone. A big brother is standing behind you, doing things behind the back. I don't want to go into a discussion on that. Before 2012, political censorship or screening was uncommon. Well, it should be before 2015. Political censorship was seldom used in depriving the rights of candidates, but this is now happening. And LegCo members who were elected were disqualified. So I'd like to obtain some figures. So for the support given to the government to disqualify candidates, eventually there were judicial reviews, and I'd like to know about the total workload involved in all these work. How much time did these offices spend in these areas of work? Dr. Kwok talked about political censorship, and this claim is outright wrong. When government counsel provide legal advice, they would offer legal expertise and advice. Other members also raise questions about certain cases in which some legislators or candidates were deprived of their candidacy or membership. But I think these claims are legally inaccurate. If a person wishes to run for an election, there are certain legal requirements to fulfill to confirm whether a nomination is effective. Of course, the circumstances differ case by case. If the circumstances lead to legal issues, and in those cases, legal advice would be needed for the RO to make a decision. Chairman, I asked for some basic figures in order to know more about your workload. I asked about the amounts of time spent by these posts in disqualifications and judicial reviews. Your time's up. Mr. Wuchiwai, third round. Thank you.
我仍然翻翻個基本觀點，第一就係話你成份文件有三個好重要嘅範圍。
The paper covers three main areas. The first, voter registration related legal issues. Number two, as other members have said, the credentials of the candidates or the legitimacy of the candidates. And number three, restarting constitutional reform. In terms of restarting constitutional reform, the understanding is that there is no timeline in the short term, so that would not be a scope of work in the short run. So I have two questions. For the CD and EU, did you come up with forecasts of the number of controversies or cases you would receive every year? Can you tell us about the trend? As for the legitimacy of the nominations. In the future, the main work of the CD and EU would be to deal with the legitimacy of candidates. How much workload do you expect to shoulder? And what is your relationship with the nominations advisory committees? And we can confirm the nominations of our candidates to the committees as well. Who's making the final decision? Would it be the CD and EU or the NACs? The candidates should be aware of this. Mr. Wong, thank you very much for the question. We are actually talking about two main areas of work, that is constitutional development and elections. For elections, we are dealing with voter registration and the confirmation of nominations. These are only two of the many areas of work, and details are already listed in the paper. Of course, we hope that the work would be smoother as we go along. And if we have a permanent head, our work would be made smoother and we can more efficiently provide legal advice. But it doesn't mean that the number of cases would not continue to rise. That's why we feel that this permanent post is necessary. And that is, we have to deal with the increasing workload. As for the nomination advisory committees and the DOJ, they each have respective roles. The work of the NACs cannot replace the legal advice of the DOJ. Ms. Alokin, third round. As a sensible legislator, we should not approve this post. As Mr. Wong said, we are dealing with lawsuits. That is whether the advice of the DOJ or the NACs should be taken. You are making this post permanent. So what kind of laws are actually being enforced, and where is the justification? I sympathize with Mr. Wong. Because he needs to defend the creation of this post. No matter how many posts you create at the DOJ, you cannot dodge a very real issue face today, and that is the disqualification of members, and there are no criteria. Are you going to judge what someone said 5 years ago or what is being said now? I'm quite sure that no current legislation can support your decision.
Needless to say, are you taking the views of the DOJ or actually the decisions made by the central government? Because you can actually move the door. Even Mr. Qiao Xiaoyang said that some people in Hong Kong publicly object to state decisions and on the one-party view. Well, I'm not asking you to comment on this. I just want to bring up one point that are you being loyal to basic law, or are you trying to make subjective decisions based on decisions made by the central government? Well, Mr. Wong, I've already used 2 minutes, and maybe he can just address the question I asked earlier. Has the returning officer consulted the government council on disqualification of candidates? Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I must point out that as a legal advisor, I would not just give any view, since there would be a lawsuit anyways. This is not a professional manner. We only do whatever is based on the law, and that would be based on the DOJ's advice. Well, actually, he didn't answer my question. Well, we've already discussed this item for over 2 hours. Would any other members like to ask questions? Because there are still many items in we need to deal with. Well, would anyone like to ask questions? Mr. Xiu Kajun, Mr. Aonoki, Mr. Chu Hoitik. All right. Third round, Mr. Xiu Kajun. No, sorry. Mr. Xiu Kajun is asking his first round. Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning. I've been listening to the discussions upstairs on the creation of a permanent post. Well, this is a post of Deputy Principal Government Counsel, but you know, from what I hear, it seems that you're actually creating a post of a Deputy Principal Hatchman. Well, we really need to make clear of the role that you're creating. Some members think that this is a hatchet man role, and I understand their views. But I would want to speak up why many members have such a view. The government itself is undermining the DOJ by using or by making inappropriate decisions and then asking for the DOJ to make an appropriate excuse. And therefore, in the views of many, the DOJ is not a fair DOJ as it used to be. Perhaps you didn't think that it would be so hard to have such a post approved, because I'm sure that you had many support in previous years, but today we see many problems. Are you trying to move the goalie post, or are you trying to make decisions based on the central government's views? We don't know. You're not just disqualifying candidates here, you're also disqualifying the professional spirit of the DOJ. This is something I really don't want to see, and it is very pitiful. Many members have asked about the work of the government council. Dr. K.K. Kwok asked how you handle your time, how much time will be put on constitutional reform, and how much time will be put on elections. Can you try to provide some information on these questions to see how you deploy your manpower? Mr. Wong. Thank you, Madam Chair. As a professional legal advisor, colleagues will not stop defending their professionalism just because they want to do something different. In 2013, there was work related to constitutional development. But then after that, till now, most of the work is related to elections. And we see this need to be continuous. Therefore, work created solely by electoral affairs will already be enough to create this new permanent post. Well, thank you. Well, after 2013, how much time is put in electoral affairs and how much time is put in constitutional affairs? What is the proportion? Is it 6-4 or 7-3? Well, most of the work actually is focused on electoral affairs right now. All right, thank you. Third round, Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Wong is quite afraid of making political decisions here, but then I think everyone sitting in this room is in some way working politically. The public believes that the DOG plays a very important in the government, hoping that the DOJ can help the public believe that the government is still being fair and unbiased. Or is the Chinese Constitution used in Hong Kong? I remember asking this question to Mr. Wong last time, and he said that it seems that there was an amendment made in the Constitution in March, and there were many issues arising from that. And the first one was that there would be Chinese characteristics added to the first article in the Constitution. So would that affect the decisions or considerations made by the CD and EU in the future? Mr. Wong, thank you, Madam Chair. As it involves the ultimate decision made by the DOJ, I'm not in a position to give you a very specific answer here. I understand Mr. Chu is concerned with China's constitution, but if you look at Article 11 of the Basic Law, it also talks about Article 31 in the Constitution, and it also mentions the system in Hong Kong in relation to the Constitution. I'm sorry, Mr. Wong, you are saying that the government may seek you for legal advice based on the amendment made to Article 1 of the Constitution. So you are not in a position to comment at this moment. I think this is a very strange answer because we cannot make a guess on how you're going to make decisions in the future. I'm sorry, your time is up. Mr. Chu, you can ask in the next round. For Mr. Chu, would you like to continue asking? Yes, Mr. Al-Nokin, you can ask first. Well, let's, Mr. Wong, let's look towards the future. I really cannot accept your view, and perhaps you might not accept my view, that maybe some issues can only be dealt via lawsuits. Well, no one can really wait for legal advice after all the lawsuits have been completed. Right now, there is a loophole. We see that there is no one standard for disqualification. Well, I'm sure that Slam Mei Fan would also agree that there is no standard right now. You don't really have a standard in disqualification. Well, of course, you know, of course, our views may be different, but there are still no set standards. Can you at least tell us how you make these standards? I don't think that has anything to do with different parties. We're actually talking about fairness here. Are you going to set up a better method to determine who is eligible and who is not? Mr. Wong. Thank you, Madam Chair. Any changes in the system involving politics and law would be led by the heads. So if necessary, the DOJ would make the determination. Well, so this is what I've been saying, that you're working for politics, because some things cannot be explained. You say that you need to disqualify someone, but then you quote what they said like a few years back. Would you also count what has been said 10 years ago? Where is the standard here? Well, you want a permanent post. You're saying that you don't have enough manpower. You need a permanent post. So do you think that you, with more people, you would also be able to come up with a definite answer? I think Mr. Au is already talking about individual cases and how to quote and how the legal basis is. So I don't think I can answer your question. Mr. Chen Qichun. Oh, I'm sorry. We have Dr. Lo Wei Kwok in the first round first. Madam Chair, this is the first time I'm speaking, but I'm not going to use up all the time because I'm going to be brief. First of all, I want to say that I support the creation of the permanent post in the LPD. Because we need strong legal support for electoral affairs. I don't understand why we have already started discussion in Monday's meeting, and yet today we have still discuss this item for 1.5 hours. I've heard many questions and comments being repeated. Madam Chair, really don't quite understand their logic. Elections and by-elections are a lot of work. I don't think that we should think that there is some sort of conspiracy theory behind the creation of the post.
If our elections require legal support,
it would be legal and constitutional. I'm sure no one can object to that. If there is an actual need, then we need the right manpower. Or else, if elections are not properly conducted, how can we explain ourselves to the voters? Some members queried why there were disqualifications in recent years and that the government has political motives. I find this hard to understand. If you run for the district council or electoral elections, there are certain requirements you must fulfill. And for people who intend to run, if their actions, speeches, and stance clearly breach the requirements, for instance, if a person does not support one country, two systems, or the basic law, how can they be allowed to run? So it is not possible to challenge the government, returning officer, or DOJ over these. So once again, I reiterate my support to the creation of this post. And as Mr. Martin Liao said it very well, and the creation of this post has taken a very long time, but nonetheless, we hope we can complete the discussion and proceed to the vote today, and then we can move on to other establishment proposals. The chairman has done a very good job because we have had so many meetings at the ESC. I do not require a response from the government, but if they wish to, they can do so. Together with the meeting in on Monday, we have discussed this item for almost 2 hours, and there are three more establishment proposals to go through. Inevitably, we would have to introduce more meeting sessions. We have met for 6 hours already, so we hope to vote on these items today, if possible. Many members are objecting to this post in principle. Dr. Priscilla Leung, first round. As the chairman of the AJLS panel, I have said that the DOJ lacks hands. I've always felt that they need to hire more quality officers. And I've something to say to the opposition. The creation of this post is certainly beneficial to the public. I have taken part in these lawsuits, and the losing party has to pay very high fees. And at the AJLS panel, I have asked for the DOJ to hire more in-house counsel. And the electoral legislation is so complicated, and the counsel fees are extremely high for all parties. So the creation of a post would benefit everyone. For constitutional affairs, you should hire people with the relevant backgrounds or provide the right training. Ms. Lok Hin talked about the legitimacy of nominations. This is not a reason for opposing the creation of this post. Instead, you should support the creation of this post, and we can discuss the other issues going forward. I'm happy to talk to you and see how we can discuss the issue with the government. That way we can alleviate the burden on the returning officers every time, and the government would not have to provide legal advice every single time. So all along I have supported the creation of posts. So for the objecting members, I hope they can consider my view. You should not make life difficult for the DOJ. We are talking about an election system and everyone plays by the same rules. Do you require any response? No. Mr. Jeremy Tam, third round. Thank you, Chairman. We have been talking about the provision of legal advice in elections. Some members mentioned the nominations advisory committees. When I look at Rule 6 or Section 6 of the EAC Ordinance, and applications can be lodged to the relevant NACs to request the NACs to provide advice on the following areas. For example, for a functional constituency or geographical constituency, whether a candidate can be nominated or whether the candidacy can be stripped. So the NACs would decide whether or not a candidate is legitimate. Can you explain why the RO has to obtain legal advice from the DOJ on whether or not to disqualify a candidate? And in the 2016 election, the returning officer did not seek advice from the NACs, but instead they sought legal advice from the DOJ. Did you tell them that they could consult the NACs instead of the DOJ? Mr. Wong, thank you. The question was mentioned on Monday as well as this morning. According to the ordinance, there are certain requirements on the responsibilities of the RO, and the DOJ would only provide legal advice in accordance with the ordinance. This is part of an outstanding lawsuit, so it is not appropriate for me to disclose the content of the discussion. You cannot explain the logic because the case is underway, but we do not know when the case would end, when we will have another by-election in half a year. So how will you deal with any issues about legitimacy of nominations? Would you follow your past practice, or are you going to defer to the NACs? Members should not talk about cases currently or outstanding lawsuits. The DOJ would offer advice based on our legal perspectives. Ms. Elvin Young, third round. Last time, we asked about the number of cases involved in election years and non-election years. They were very different. For election years, they were as high as 1,200 cases per year, and for non-election years, 600 or 700 per year. There were three professionals in the unit responsible for the work, and you said that if necessary, staff from other units might be deployed. I'd like to know how many staff were redeployed. In 2016, there were 236 cases. There were three staff in the unit. So how many staff and who had to be redeployed from other units? Mr. Wong. Paragraph 14 of the paper contains the details. And on polling day, for example, more staff had to be deployed. So perhaps Mr. Mui can offer more details. Thank you. Thank you for the question. The daily work is taken up by the several staff. They were supernumerary staff and two other staff members of the unit. During busy periods, we had to redeploy staff from other units in the legal policy division. So this has been our practice. Chairman, paragraph 14 mentioned the two elections in September and December 2016, and for the chief executive election, were any staff redeployed? Mr. Mui. Paragraph 14 mentioned the elections in 2016 and 17, as well as this chief executive election. A number of council had been recruited. To act as assistant returning officer legal on polling day. So the nature is different from the internal work of the DOJ. The clerk reminded me that this item were discussed for 1 hour and 15 minutes 2 days ago, and together with this morning, we are on this for 3 hours already. Mr. Ray Chen, Ms. Eddie Xu, fourth round. After they ask their questions, I would put this item to the vote. Mr. Ray Chen. I want to follow up on what Dr. Priscilla Leung said. She said many PAN Democrats asked about the disqualifications, and we should support the creation of this role before we sit down and have a discussion. Should we, who would actually discuss the issue with members? Is it the CM, maybe REO, or this new post at the DOJ? If the item is passed, we would request separate voting at the Finance Committee. And before the 2015 District Council election, there were more than 1,500 cases, so I want to obtain more figures. In the 2010 District Council, how many cases were there before the election? And before the 2015 and 2012 legislative elections, how many cases were there? Or 2012 and 2016? And there were 1,500 cases before the 2015 District Council election, so obviously there were issues. Did you review what those issues were and what led to a spike in the number of cases?
Have you reviewed it? Or do you have a mechanism for review, or is it the responsibility of the REO? Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, I understand that different parties should sit down and talk about it. Only 1,500 cases, I think Mr. Holden Chow mentioned it in the last meeting. that there were many of these objections and challenges arising from this voter registration. And in my response to Mr. Chow, I said that we are going to work with the CMAB to see whether there is any structural issues and how we can enhance the system. Fifth round, Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, thank you for encouragement to ask one more round. I asked about the amendment of the Constitution. The new list of Chinese Communist Party is the basic feature of a country with Chinese characteristics. Well, I don't think this is not something easily understood by the public. So I'd like to ask the Solicitor General how you interpret this amendment legally and whether you would need to ask for assistance from the central government. Mr. Wong, thank you. The DOJ provides support for the different divisions. We provide support to divisions and not only to bureaus and departments because we give advice to the returning officers. Well, I really don't understand what you are trying to say, Mr. Wong. Therefore, the legal advice given to the divisions would not be made public. No, I'm asking you about that amendment in the Constitution on how you're going to interpret it from a professional angle and whether you are going to seek interpretation assistance from the central government. Mr. Wong, we will only interpret it when legal advice is sought. So this is exactly what I've been trying to say in my answer. Well, if there are no more questions in the first round, then I would like to put this item to vote. I claim a division. All right. And now put this item to vote. Please check your votes before voting is closed. Voting is closed. Results are displayed. 30 present, 17 in favor, 12 in objection. So this item is approved. So there will be separate voting at the Finance Committee. We are now going to adjourn the meeting. The next meeting will be at 8:30 on June 20th. Thank you.